Thank you so much. Good morning and a really warm welcome this morning. My name is Alyson and it is a privilege to lead us in our service this morning. There's a creche in full flow already, feel free to make use of it, and there will be sessions for our younger members of the church family upstairs shortly after together time. Our service is the second and final one in our mini-series of two on identity. You can always watch the first one on Catch Up on YouTube if you missed it last week. And we look forward to Ben, our vicar, speaking to us from God's Word later. Do come and say hello at the end if you are visiting. It's really lovely to have you with us. And a very warm welcome to those who've joined online as well. As we gather, let me open with a prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to come together freely and humbly to praise and worship you, to hear your word, and to encourage one another on together. May you receive glory from all that we think and say and do. In Jesus' name, amen. Our five-year vision is built on the two pillars of Bible study and prayer, both of which we will be doing this morning. But part of our vision includes O, which is opportunities to show God's love practically. And during our first song, if you've brought any Easter eggs, do bring them up during the song. And the local charity that we support called Spurgeon's will deliver them to families who'd not otherwise be able to afford them. Next week, there is also the opportunity to do the same if you've missed out this week. So, let's stand to sing if you're able as we join in praising our great Creator God, and do bring any eggs to the front. Thank you. Do stand.
Thank you.
Have a seat. Well, as we join together, as we are completely honest with ourselves, we know that we have not lived lives that honour our Creator God, this great God that we've just sung about, who is completely holy. We have not always thought, said, or done the right thing, and we need his forgiveness. So we will join together in the confession. If you would like to sign with me, please do, as a response to the words, Father, forgive us, when we say, save us and help us, we will do this, save us and help us. Save us and help us. God our Father, we come to you sorry for our sins, for turning away from you and not thinking about what you want for our lives. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For behaving just as we want, without doing what you want for us. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. And for the things we've thought and said that don't bring you glory, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For acting as if we are ashamed to be trusting in Jesus, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. May God, who is powerful and loving, forgive us and give us strength by his Spirit to live our new lives trusting in Jesus. Amen. And I'll just read that beautiful reminder from the Bible. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Amen. Well, this morning, our youngest members of the church family are beginning a new series on King Jesus. And they will be learning about him through the eyes of Peter, one of Jesus' best friends. And our young people in SOS are beginning a new series on how to practically live out their faith on a daily basis. Do ask our young people what they've learnt. And parents, a reminder that there's a takeaway sheet that comes home with them if they're a little less forthcoming or have forgotten when you ask them. And a little shout out that next week we'd love to welcome the younger members of our church family, bringing their mothers for a Mother's Day breakfast upstairs before the service when they get to serve their mums, and of course they can bring their dads as well. And if you get a chance to let me know that you're coming, that would be marvellous, just for numbers of catering purposes. And a second shout out for the church family away day. This is really exciting. I, in our vision, inspired worship together. Bookings are now open via the website or the office for our church family away day, Saturday 22nd and Sunday the 23rd of June. a great opportunity to grow in love and our bonds of affection as a church family together. There's a barn dance in the evening. I mean, that sounds fun on the Saturday with food, so you don't have to eat before you come. You come, have your tea, have a dance. One before the other, I'm not sure which works best. And then on the Sunday, we come back for a full day of teaching and worship with a guest speaker, and there will be activities and craft and sport in the afternoon and time to relax together. So do think about coming. Do look, maybe you've already saved the date, but look at the website and book yourselves on. That would be brilliant. And before we go, or before the children go, it is the first Sunday in March. So if your birthday falls in March, we would love to offer you a cupcake with our hospitality team after the service. They'd be delighted to serve you. But just now, if you're under 18 and would like to come up, we'd love to give you a little gift from the church family and pray with you. So any under 18s, let's sing to you if you can come up. Can we sing? Carolyn, oh, thanks, Carolyn.
To you, to Jesus, we do. God bless you.
So much. Let's pray for our young people today. Heavenly Father, thank you so much that you have fearfully and wonderfully made each one of us. And we pray for our young people and our older people as they celebrate their birthdays this month. May they know that they are precious and valued by you. Thank you, Lord. Bless them this day and keep them safe in the days to come. In Jesus' name, amen. And before you go, would you like to come and choose something from the birthday box as well? You girls, you may have a seat, but I'm just going to ask Martha, why are you dressed as... Oh, by the way, it's Martha's birthday today, so happy birthday today, Martha. But can you just tell me why you've come to church today as a sheep?
I'm not a sheep, I'm a lamb, because it's nearly Easter.
Ah, it's nearly Easter, so you've come just to remind us that it's nearly Easter and you are the lamb. Oh, thank you so much, Martha. Well, that's really helpful.
That's a really good reminder, because Alyson forgot to mention that on the 28th of March, that's on Monday, Thursday, that's the day before Good Friday, we are going to have an Easter Passover, Seder Meal. It's the Jewish Passover feast for the Passover. I'm not sure whether we have all lamb, but it's not obligatory at Passover in Jewish tradition now. But we will be celebrating that at St. Philip's. There is a flyer about it. We have a friend who is a Messianic Jew, that is a Jew who believes in Jesus, who is going to come and explain all the different parts of it, the bitter herbs, the cup. I think you're going to get a quarter of a boiled, hard-boiled egg, if it's hard-boiled. It will be an evening, I think, where we go through the Jewish Passover, which shows the way into the Passover before the Good Friday and Easter. So do sign up for that. There are already quite a few people who have taken one of the flyers. It would be lovely if you could join us.
Thank you, John. And that also brings on the Easter flyers for after the Maundy Thursday Passover meal. There, all the details of the Easter services coming up are on the green sheet as you leave. Do take one for yourself, take one or two or three or four for some friends and neighbours, and do offer them to other people to invite them to come along and join in Easter celebrations. It would be great to have visitors and friends with us. We know that through the years, God is good and faithful and perfect and sovereign. And as we sing about that now, the children and young people will be able to leave with their groups. So please do stand if you're able, and we will sing, "There is strength within the sorrow." Do stand. Mm-hmm. Do have a seat. As you've probably picked up already, there is a lot going on in our churches across the parish. So do please read the full and updated details in our recent weekly newsletter. It was emailed on Friday, and there are some hard copies in the church for anyone not on email on a green sheet at the back, and they are also on the website. Just so much going on, and we've highlighted a few things already, but two extra things, and then there are other details in the notice sheet. T in our vision, teaching and discipling God's word. The parish Lent course continues on Tuesdays. It was great to look at the life of Samson in the Old Testament, a hero, but not quite a great hero, this week, but with amazing shadows of the cross. And we're continuing this coming Tuesday, 7:30 upstairs. Still not too late to join. Do ask me or anyone who came last week if you want to find out more. And our perspectives, E, on our vision, Every Word Spoken for Jesus, the spring edition of Perspectives is out this weekend. And we'd love some help to distribute across the town. So if you had a look at the names of streets and think if you could pick up a pile at the back and then deliver in the coming days, that would be much appreciated. Or just take a copy or two and knock on your neighbour's door and give them that. And it's a great way to sort of build relationships in the community and perhaps connect them to the church. So do look at the newsletter with a cup of tea at home and see what you would like to take note of. Now I would like to invite Isaac and Alex up for our readings. Thank you.
Our first readings this morning are taken from Genesis, so chapter 1, verses 26 to 27, and chapter 2, verses 19 to 25. So firstly, chapter 1, starting at verse 26, which can be found on page 3 of the Pew Bibles. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God he created them. Male and female he created them. And then chapter 2, starting at verse 19. Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man." That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. Adam and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from the Apostle Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 5, verses 14 to 17. You can find this on page 1161 in the Pew Bibles, 1161. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14. For Christ's love compels us, because we're convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Just in case, the water. Do keep your Bibles open. We'll be particularly in Genesis chapter 2. There should be some slides up on the screens which will help us this morning. If you go to the Science Museum, you will have the chance to discover yourself in the Who Am I exhibition. I quote, "What makes you smarter than a chimp? What makes you smile? What makes you, you?" There's a question. What makes you, you? Throughout history, scientists, theologians, historians have dedicated their lives to answering that question. Who am I? What about my relationships? Great questions to ponder. Who am I? It is a foundational question. It is a matter of identity. It is the question in our time and place, of our culture. So as Christians, we need help to speak into that question warmly, winsomely, and for the glory of Christ. Let me say at the start, as I said last week in part one of this two-part mini-series, however you come here this morning, whether in a relationship or single, whether you are same-sex attracted or opposite-sex attracted, God loves you. We love you. You are welcome here. We want to support you, not push you away, because we need to support one another. There is a real confusion on this topic of identity and relationships. Everyone's trying to work out the best way to live. But thankfully, we're not left alone to work that out. The God of the universe, who made us, and he knows us better than we know ourselves, he's spoken in his word, the Bible, to tell us his plans and purposes. That is great news when we're all searching for different answers in different places. Inevitably, this will challenge some of our preconceptions or what we hear in the news or the workplace or other places. And the challenges may feel very personal because identity is fundamental to our lives. Yet the Bible reassures us that God is a good God. God wants the best for us, and his ways are the best for us. Jesus said, John 10:10, "I have come that you may have life and have it to the full." Yet following Jesus will also be hard for each of us in different ways. Jesus says in Matthew 16, if we want to follow him, we will have to take up our cross to do so. Following Jesus is painful and hard at times. Repentance and faith, they can be hard and painful, but it is so worth it because Jesus is so worth it. God is good. God wants the best for us, and God's way is the best for us. Identity and relationships, it's not a topic I've preached on before from the pulpit or the lectern in the parish, and we're not going to cover everything there is to say in two sermons. Or indeed everything we've said this last year and a half as we've thought about identity and relationships in different ways. So do keep asking questions. Do seek to understand more. Come and talk to me. I can also point you in the direction of someone else to talk to if that would help more. But I hope that whatever is said over these 2 weeks, that will help all of us, whoever we are, as we seek to understand what it means for each of us to be who we are in this time and place. For some of us, these things will be directly affecting us. For others, they may be affecting our loved ones. For all of us as Christians, we all need help at speaking to those we know and meet into all that's happening in our culture and our national church at the moment. We need to be warm, winsome, and for the glory of Christ. I wouldn't naturally have chosen to speak on these things, but our culture and our national church have made them the issue of the moment. And as a local church leader, it would be remiss of me not to speak on them. A final word of introduction, before we look at this, these passages. Over these two topical sermons, we are going to run longer than the aim for 20 minutes. It is a long sermon this morning. Part of me wants to apologise for that. Another part of me says, actually, no, we need to deal with these topics as well as we can. Please bear with me as an exception on a massive, massive topic. So they're the words of introduction. Do please have your Bibles ready, and we need God's help to understand what's in his word now. I'm going to pray. Heavenly Father, help us humble ourselves before you and your word this morning. Remove our preconceptions and the baggage we bring to your word. Would your spirit make us wise to understand what you're saying now? Teach us about you, about ourselves, and change our lives through it for our good and for your glory. Amen. Who am I? And what about my relationships? Three things this morning. We are created by God. We are created for relationship. And we are new creations in Christ. First, we begin at the beginning, in Genesis. We are created by God. Genesis 1:26, then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness. Verse 27, so God created mankind in his own image. And my little sister, she's 13 years younger than me. She was, by all accounts, an unexpected surprise to my parents. The fact that my dad poured a pint of beer down his shirt in shock when mum told him shows he wasn't expecting it. Charlotte is a beautiful gift, but she was a surprise to my parents, though not to God. And that is really important. However our conception came about, none of us sat here now, different as we each and all are. No one who has ever lived is a surprise to God. We've all been created by a God who loves creating things. And who especially loves every person he's created. Each unique. There is no one else like you on this planet. God made you, you. And that is beautiful and that is amazing. We are each and all created by God. Each of us unique. All made in God's image. So we are each and all inherently loved by God. Like a craftsman who brings a sculpture to life from a piece of rock, God has brought us into being. He's crafted each of us, made each of us unique. However you come here this morning, however you might feel about yourself this morning, and we know only too well our struggles and our failings, the things in our hearts, we are each dearly loved by the one who's given us life. And with that comes inherent significance, value, worth to our lives, all and equally together. We are made in God's image. Nothing else in all creation reflects God like you do, created by God. But that does mean we're not gods ourselves, which may challenge us. We're not masters of our own destiny. The rule book for life isn't ours to write. That belongs to God, our creator. He sets the boundaries for life, for us, his creatures. But we can trust God. Again, God is good. God wants the best for us. And God's way is the best for us. We are each and all created by God. The second thing we see is that we're created for relationships. Created for relationship. By his nature, God is relational. The Bible teaches one God, three persons, Father, Son, and Spirit. And whatever our exact take on Genesis 1:26, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness. There is at least an inference of God's relational nature there. So being created in the image of God means we are created as relational beings for relationship with God and with each other. Verse 27, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. The key relationship we're created for is with God, with our Creator. Verse 26, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness. So it's fair to say, in terms of identity, that the way to be our true selves, that the people we were made to be, only comes through a relationship with our Creator God. We will never find our true selves if we seek to live independent of God. Yet as we read on in the Bible, there is a shocking discovery. From Genesis chapter 3 onwards, through the rest of the Bible, we're told that each of us naturally has a broken relationship with God. We are all made in God's image, but we are naturally all broken images. Naturally rebelling against God, wanting to be gods of ourselves, rulers over our own lives. So sadly, each of us is naturally less than the people we were created to be. Wonderfully, though, the Bible teaches us there is a way to come back to God. Jesus tells us there is a way, but there's only one way. John 14:6, Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus says, trusting in him, we can each find our true identity. That the right relationship with God we each so desperately need. If you want to discover who you are, well, what it means to embrace your true identity in all its fullness, the first step is to come into a right relationship with God. Turn and trust in Jesus. Or as Jesus says in Mark 1:15, repent and believe the good news. Become a Christian. If you are here today not a Christian, if you're not trusting in Jesus with your life, I'd urge you to do so. Come and speak to me or another leader in the church, a trusted Christian friend. We would love to talk to you more about that. Created for relationship with God, but we're also created for relationship with one another. Genesis 1:27, God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. True humanity comes not only in relating to God, but also in relating to others. And our relationships come in lots of different shapes and sizes. We have family relationships, we have friendships, we have work relationships, we have romantic, sexual relationships, we have relationships through sport or other shared interests. We've got networks of relationships, and they all function in different ways. And that is great, because we're all wired for relationship. It isn't that we all have to have every type of relationship. Some people don't have work relationships, but they've got really strong family networks. Some people have romantic sexual relationships, others don't, but they have strong friendship bonds with others, or they're involved in the lives of others in different ways. At heart, whatever it looks like, we are created as relational creatures. Right at the start, Genesis 1 and 2, before the fall and it all went wrong. We are created for relationship with God and with each other. And we could take any of those relationships as an example and preach topically on them. Relationships in the workplace, in the family, good friendships. And maybe we will do that another time. Identity and relationships is a really broad topic. But in this mini-series, where sexuality and relationships are such high profile in our culture and in our national church at the moment, we're going to think for a few brief minutes about the romantic sexual relationships some of us embark on.
so that we might help each other speak with those we know and meet warmly, winsomely, and for the glory of Christ. Created by God. So as we've already said, God sets the boundaries for life for us, his creatures, including in this area of romantic sexual relationships. So what does the Bible, God's authority for what we believe and how we behave, what does it say about this area of our lives? Well, three phrases summarise the Bible's teaching on our romantic sexual relationships. God is for sex, sex is for marriage, and marriage is for one man and one woman. And I would understand if you're already thinking that is just too hard. Maybe that sounds like really bad news for some of us. Certainly it's not what we want to hear. But remember, God loves us. God made us. We can trust God. God is good. God wants the best for us. God's ways are the best for us. Well, let's look briefly at how the Bible teaches those three things. God is for sex. God created sex. It is a good thing. Genesis 1:27, God created humanity, male and female, he created them, part of which is they have a sexual relationship. Verse 28, God says, be fruitful and increase in number. It's not the only reason, but a key reason for creating sex is procreation. Sex is God's gift to the world to make more people, including my little sister. Another purpose in giving us the gift of sex comes in Genesis 2, verse 18. God says, it's not good for the man to be alone. I will make a suitable helper for him. Verse 22, then the Lord God made a woman and he brought her to the man. God sees a need for Adam to have a relationship with someone like him, but different to him. So Eve is created. The same as Adam, equal to him, male and female, both made equally in God's image, but she's different to him. Male and female, they're complementary. They're different examples of the same thing. And that leads to a profound unity when they come together in sexual union. Verses 24 and 25, this intimacy makes them one flesh. Adam and Eve's marriage is a pattern for all romantic sexual relationships. Verse 24, that is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife and they become one flesh. A man and woman start a new family unit by leaving their parents and becoming one flesh. God created sex and marriage as good gifts for humanity. It's the place of his blessing on our romantic sexual relationships. God is for sex. It is a good thing and it's part of God's creation. Sex is for marriage. Jesus reinforces the teaching of Genesis in the Gospels. Matthew 19, verses 5 and 6, Jesus quotes Genesis 1 and 2. God joins couples together in marriage and makes them one. God has designed it that two people are knitted together like a jigsaw puzzle, interlocking. Sex is part of that process. The Bible teaches sex is for marriage, and Jesus refers to sex outside marriage as wrong. Mark chapter 7, verses 20 to 23, it's on page 1010. We had it read as part of the sermon last week. There's a list here of different sins that come out of our hearts and work themselves out in our lives. Desires of our hearts that lead to sinful behaviour. There's a whole list of them. Greed, deceit. But among them is what Jesus refers to in verse 21 as sexual immorality. That word Jesus uses is in the original language porneia, and it refers to all sex outside marriage. Jesus is saying that all sex outside marriage is wrong. And let's be honest, in our culture today that sounds just so weird to us. Where sex between two consenting adults over 16 is fine. The biblical view is so countercultural. We can sometimes be wrongly, and hear this wrongly, fixated on same-sex relationships in the church. Jesus spreads the net way wider than that. Jesus says, for all of us, whoever we are, any sex outside marriage is wrong. God is for sex. Sex is for marriage. And marriage is for one man and one woman. Marriage in the Bible is based in creation. That God created male and female and sexual difference. That's why we have marriage. It is what marriage is about. Man and woman, each different, becoming one. Why can't it be any other way? Well, it is what God says in his word, so we do have to accept that. But God also gives us some beautiful reasons why he says it. Marriage in God's creation points to some amazing truths. Let me share just two of those truths with you from the Bible. One, marriage reflects God's nature in the Trinity. Deuteronomy 6:4, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Yet God is also three persons. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. God's nature is equal and different. There is difference in unity. There are three persons united as one. Marriage is designed as a picture of that. Two persons united as one. Marriage is designed, three different persons united as one in the Trinity. In marriage, two different persons united as one. Marriage is designed to reflect something of God's very nature. We break that picture any other way, no matter how loving or faithful that union is. The second thing, marriage also reflects Jesus' relationships with the church. In Ephesians chapter 5, we're told that marriage is a picture of the ultimate wedding relationship between Jesus and his church. Jesus is the bridegroom. The church is his bride. But the point is that the church is not the same as Jesus. They are different, but they are made one with Jesus through faith. We break that picture any other way, no matter how loving or faithful that union is. Marriage is designed by God to be between one bride and one bridegroom, united together as one. God is for sex. Sex is for marriage. Marriage is for one man and one woman. And I am really aware, again, this may be personal and real for a number of us. Maybe you are same-sex attracted, or some of your nearest and dearest are. Maybe you are opposite-sex attracted and single, and you long to be in a sexual relationship with someone. We all need to keep hearing that God loves you. God loves those we love. You are welcome here. We want to support you, not push you away, because we need to support each other. And the reality is we all struggle in this area of sex and relationships, whether we're same-sex attracted or opposite-sex attracted, or whether we're married or single. Not one of us stands on a pedestal. We all fall short in this area of our lives and so many other areas of our lives. We all need God's grace and the space to work through these things. And we all need the constant encouragement from the Bible that we can trust God, that God is good, God wants the best for us, and God's way is the best for us. And when we get these things wrong, which we all do, God offers forgiveness to all who ask him, to all who turn to him and say sorry, asking for strength and help to follow his ways. We all need forgiveness, strength, and help from God. And God loves to give it when we ask. God delights to forgive us when we mess up, and he delights to strengthen us by his Spirit. God is the God of new starts. He's the God of new days. He is the God of new beginnings. And that brings us to our final point this morning. In matters of identity and relationships created by God, created for relationship with God and with one another, and for all those trusting in Jesus, we are new creations in Christ. God gives us these patterns for our identity and relationships in creation. They are pre-fall, so they are for all humanity, for the good and flourishing of all people. if we will pattern our lives on the patterns God tells us are for our best life. Though since the fall, it is understandable we've drifted. Sometimes we've purposefully turned away from the patterns God says are for our best life. Images as we each are of God, we are nevertheless, since the fall, each and all naturally broken images. Yet in his love, God continues to call us back to himself. He calls us to repent, to turn from our sin to Christ, to walk in his ways as new creations. Whoever we are, whatever we've done, Jesus came for each and every single one of us. He gave his life for us that we can be made new, renewed, as we turn and trust in him. That's what God's love offers, to be forgiven, to be made new in Christ. And that's what we are as Christians, new creations in Christ. We're not good people, certainly no better than anyone else. We are just forgiven sinners, now called to walk in obedience as Jesus' followers. That was the other reading this morning. The last place we'll bounce around, 2 Corinthians 5, page 1162, if you want to turn to it, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here. You might describe your identity by any number of categories. For example, where you were born, where you live, your gender, your relationship status, the type of job you do, the sports team you support. But God ultimately sees only two types of people. Jesus talks a lot about different pairs in the world. Sheep and goats, wheat and weeds, wise and foolish, two groups. Unique as each of us are, God ultimately only sees two groups of people in the world. 2 Corinthians 5:17 has two groups of people. Those living in the new way through faith in Jesus, and those still living in the old way, not trusting in Jesus. Those in Christ, and those not in Christ. The technical term is those in faith union with Christ and those not yet trusting in Jesus. When we trust in Jesus, we're made new in him. The new creation has come. We become a new member of God's family. We have a new and eternal hope in heaven and a new start in life now. We are new creations. So in terms of how the Bible splits people, how would you define yourself? Who am I? Well, I'm a man, I'm a son, a father, a husband, I'm a vicar, I'm an Englishman, I'm an East Anglian. I could go on. But by God's grace, I am in Christ. The new has come, the old has gone. I am a new creation. I wasn't born a Christian. I grew up in a Christian family. I gave my life to Jesus at the age of 13 on a Christian camp in the Lake District. And now I am his, and he is mine. And for all my brokenness, my future is safe and secure in him. If you are here today as a Christian, that is your story. There was an old way of living, but trusting in Jesus, the new has come. And that defines who you are, what you think, how you live. If we are Christians here this morning, our identity is in Christ, and that shapes everything. The old is gone. The past is forgiven. It's paid for by the blood of Jesus. We are part of Jesus' family, forgiven and accepted, secure in Christ, ready to start a new life with him now, and into eternity. When we belong to Jesus and give ourselves to him, that defines who we are. And if you are a Christian here this morning, that new identity means a new life. 2 Corinthians 5:15, we no longer live for ourselves, but for him who died for us and was raised again. We now live for Jesus, not ourselves, our Lord and our Saviour. Jesus defines who we are, what we think, how we live, because we trust that Jesus knows what's best for us. Following Jesus changes everything. It shapes how we see ourselves. Our new identity is belonging to Jesus. So we trust and obey what he says by his Spirit in his word, the Bible, even if it goes against our culture. The world says we can be whoever we feel we want to be. The Bible says, don't do that. Be who God's made you to be. That is your best life, with an identity in Christ, which defines how you think and how you live. And here, I want to say really clearly that being same-sex attracted is not a sin, any more than being opposite-sex attracted is not a sin. There are lots of same-sex attracted Christians in the world seeking to live faithfully for Jesus. The Living Out website and material is so helpful in that area. The actual question, if we are calling ourselves Christians, for each and every one of us equally, whether we're same-sex attracted or opposite-sex attracted, whether we're married, whether we're single, the question for all of us equally is, are we using our bodies and relationships in a way that honours the Lord Jesus? That question applies equally to all of us, and none of us stands on a pedestal in that. We all struggle and get things wrong. It's why we need each other to help each other, to keep following Jesus faithfully, whoever we are. But maybe you're here now not a believer, you're not a Christian, and you long for a new start, you long for a new beginning, you long for a new life, whoever you are. Well, that's what God sent Jesus into the world to bring. For anyone and everyone who will come to Jesus in repentance and faith, for me, for you. Some people find it really hard to come to church. They think they're unworthy, that they don't fit in. They feel the reality of their past is so bad, or there are things about themselves that are so bad that there's no place for them in the church family. I felt like that for years. I stayed away from church. For me, it was relationships and also drinking and perhaps other things you can't buy quite as easily over the counter in the supermarket. But when I was younger, I had lots of relationships with girls. And then one girl in particular. We lived together for a number of years. Though I'd stopped calling myself a Christian by then. I knew my life, my pattern of life, my priorities in life, they were more about me than Jesus. The thought of being a hypocrite kept me away from church. Until God chose to show me, through the heartache of that breakup, that I didn't have to sort myself out before I could come to him, that he loved me how I was. He wanted me to come to him in all my breaths, all my mess, and my brokenness, just as I was. And it was in that place, as I turned and trusted in him, no longer myself, God forgave me, and then he began his work of remaking me. For all I still get wrong today as a sinner, all that's still in my heart that wants to live for me and not Jesus, I am nevertheless today, by God's grace, a forgiven sinner. I am certain of my relationship with God because of Jesus. And I am trying out of that, with his Spirit's help, to follow him as faithfully as I can in all he tells me is for my good and his glory. If God will accept me, he will accept you. Look again at 2 Corinthians 5:17. If anyone is in Christ, anyone. It doesn't matter what our past is. It doesn't matter what we have or haven't done. God loves us and he wants us to be in his forever family. Anyone can be in the new creation. Anyone can. And it is great and glorious news. If that is you, please come and see me. Get in touch. Come on one of our Hope Explored or other courses. Come on Sundays. Come for coffee. Whoever you are, whatever you've done, however you feel, I would love to talk to you more about the glorious new life Jesus offers anyone who will turn and trust in him. We're going to finish now. We've covered a lot again this morning. And maybe you want to pray about these things or something else. Do find someone you came with or any of us who've taken part in the service this morning if you want to talk and pray. And whether you're here as a Christian or not, Please don't leave upset or unsettled. Talk to me. Talk today. If not today, get in touch. I would love to talk and pray with you as we help and support one another. I've also left some books at the back on sexuality and relationships, especially same-sex relationships. If that's something you want to think more on, do take a book. They are free to keep for anyone who wants to just take and read one. Why don't I pray as we finish now? Father God, thank you that you made and you love every single one of us. Thank you for your care and your compassion for all you've made. Thank you for the new life you offer everyone, life and health and hope as we turn and trust in Jesus. Thank you for the work you do in our lives by your Spirit to then make us more like Jesus. Forgive us for not relating rightly to you or others. By your Spirit, help us to be image bearers who glorify you with our words and our lives that clearly proclaim, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And in Jesus' name we pray now. Amen.
Thank you, Ben. This is a communion service, and there'll be a moment shortly where we take time to really reflect on Christ's blood shed for us. Having heard some of these awesome, creative, sovereign, wise works of God, we are going to join with people all over the world to proclaim what we believe. And we're going to do that by singing. So do stand if you're able as we declare our faith in God in the words of the next song.
Thank you. you please be seated? As we come now to our time of prayer to share here in the church and with you at home as well, let's pray, opening with Paul's prayer to the Ephesians. For this reason, we kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. We pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen us with power through his Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And pray that we, being rooted and established in love, may have the power, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses all knowledge, that we may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Amen. Amen. As we lift our hearts in prayer, so lift up all the nations and their leaders. We pray for King Charles and for his health, and for our national and local leaders and all who lead in this parish in whatever way. We pray earnestly for peace and stability in all those countries beset by violence and war, and where there are tensions that could spark into conflict. May hope come to those in despair, and shelter and food to the homeless. In a moment's silence now, let's hold up those peoples and situations that are on our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, lift up our families, friends, and all those who surround us. Bless and strengthen our mission partners. May they see the fruits of their work in changed lives and people turning to you. We pray for all those working with families, children, and young people, for the regular groups here today, and for more helpers in this important area of ministry. Lord, in your mercy, lift up those suffering in any way and those who care for and support them. We pray for all those who work in our hospitals, care homes, and as carers in the community, together with those unseen carers, some of them children, looking after family members. May resources, so stretched as they are, be allocated in proportion to need. We name now in our hearts those we know particularly in need of your comfort and presence at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear us as we remember those who are no longer with us and give comfort to all who mourn the loss of loved ones. May they know the comfort and presence of the Lord as their shepherd in their time of distress. Lord, in your mercy. And as we prepare to share round your table, we pray again with Paul. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
As we pray to the God of peace, who calls us by faith into his family, our brothers and sisters in Christ at peace with one another. So we're going to take a moment to share that peace together now. Let me invite you to stand if you're able to do that. I'm going to say, the peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Do take this moment to offer one another a sign of that peace. Thank you.
Do remain. The children and young people are coming back. Why don't you just take a moment to, as we remain standing, say hello and we welcome them back in. They may come in sort of dribs and drabs over the next minute or two. Ask them what they got up to. Oh, you don't have to. It just might be a nice thing to ask them. I'm going to say, the Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life, that by faith we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. I'll give you the chance to say that one again. I can see it on the screens. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. Do take your seats. On the night that he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, by your Holy Spirit, may this bread and wine be to us, by faith, the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise, and lift our voices to join you in eternal song, in the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And do join with me as we pray together the prayer the Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share. If you are trusting in the Lord Jesus, if you've been baptised and regularly receive the bread and the wine, you're welcome to hold your hand out to receive. That may not be for everyone here, which is fine. If that isn't you, please don't feel awkward about remaining in your seat or keeping your hands by your side as you come for a prayer. If receiving communion isn't for you, it's better to do those things. This is a meal for those who are trusting in the Lord Jesus, who are committed to living for him in spite of our sinfulness, and who are united and at peace with one another. The Bible warns us against receiving the bread and the wine if that's not how we come together this morning. We're urged to examine ourselves before receiving. But that said, all those who are broken and want to turn to Christ for strength and hope, draw near with faith, eat and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you. And we're going to serve here at the rail in two lines. Do come up as the stewards direct. If that's too far for some, if mobility is harder, we'll also serve from St. Nick's Chapel to my right, your left. The stewards won't line people up there, but do feel free to head over there. And if you are coming to the front, please do ask if you need any help with the steps on the way up. You're welcome to kneel or stand at the rail. And finally, do let me encourage us all as we celebrate this glorious meal together to smile at one another as we head back to our seats.
Thank you.
Our closing song is all about Jesus, who has, through his death on the cross, given us the opportunity to become new creations, living in relationship with God. Let's praise him with our voices and our hearts. Do stand if you're able. Life-changing truths. It's been great to be able to join in worship together this morning. As we come to the end of our formal time of worship, do stay for refreshments. Chat about the sermon, pray with each other, say hello to someone that you don't recognise. And please do all that once you've collected your... Oh, they're all here. Children. If you would like to give to the work of the parish, there is a plate and a card reader in the foyer. As we stand, let's close with a final prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you for our time together this morning. We thank you that through the power of the Holy Spirit, you transform us, renewing our minds and bringing us new life in Jesus. Help us to go out into the day and into this week, allowing you to be Lord of our hearts and our lives and our relationships, and being prepared to love and serve you and those you bring us into contact with. And may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.